All right, they're just trying to steal some comps from the team of the move. Let's see how well Jamili can perform here on Shadow Priest. Definitely one of the most notable multi-classers in the game. If anyone can do it, it will be him. We see cheap shots from Roasties early on to peel up Mezzan Trill, denying them from getting to their target. Jamili interrupting that Vampiric Touch, likely to see a Death Grip. There's an Incapacitate. Mez moves over for the Death Grip. Potentially, no, they're actually just going to swap to Garecki. Cap Totem on Jamili. He trinkets that aggressively, potentially to support Garecki as well. In the meantime, Seedu gets swapped to by Roasties as both teams gun down the healer.
Yeah, Astral Shift gets traded up by Garecki. Unfortunately for Method Orange, Mez wasn't there for any of the damage, but now all over him. Big pressure on Garecki very early on. Double Fear coming in from Jamili to keep him alive, but this might be the Spirit Link. Gets Blood Elf silenced. Blood Life Swap comes in from Jamili as well, so that's a big defensive cooldown forced out by Method Orange on Noble.
But they did not overlap, which was a critical move there for Garecki to survive later on. But the damage from Method Orange is just so high at this point. Roasties is trying to gun down for Seedu, but there's no damage there. Interrupt onto the heal. Garecki digital low, gripped on the jump, into the silence. Seedu all over him with potential purges. There's a Spearling Totem. He gets to it, connects it, and stays alive. But momentum completely in favor of Method Orange.
Yeah, Trill still has a touch of karma as well, so he can afford to play a little bit aggressive silence now onto Seedu, as Noble struggling to find pressure in this matchup. A little bit of damage now onto Trill. Still has a touch of karma, like I said, though. Kidney shot now into Seedu. Finally, Noble getting that raw pressure out. We know RPS has, but Garecki still in so much trouble. Not a single defensive cooldown left as he leaps away, trying anything he can to stay alive. The healing wave comes out, fakes out some of the interrupts. DR Asphyxiate comes in, and ultimately, Method Orange with the healer race will win that and claim game number one.
They're still playing it out. They kick Seedu on the heel. Evasion activated. Vendetta, kidney shot. No trinket. Could be potential cross kill. Trill trying to support. Jamili moves in. Has the fear. Seedu could ultimately fall. Cross kill. Roasties, though, with no cooldowns. Mez has Icebound Fortitude, but Trill has no touch of karma. Portals for the heal. Roasties is going to fall here. I believe the damage is enough. Can Jamili 1v2 is now the question. Trill is dangerous low and dotted up behind the pillar. Mez has cooldowns. He's going to be leading the charge, trying to buy space. He silences, trying to stall out the Icebound Fortitude, but Jamili can't stay in this. He's got dispersion. He's staying alive. Trill rotting down still to the dots, but even if Trill falls, I don't think Jamili can take Mez out. He's going to try. Icebound Fortitude gets activated, gets feared on. Jamili trying to go for the 1v2. Trill's in Shadow with Death Rage, but he just can't get in line of sight, and he's ultimately going to fall, I believe. Jamili trying his best there in those final moments, but it will not be enough. Method Orange, bring the aggression.
Yeah, I almost called that a little bit too early. That was very close. Method Orange, like you said, very, very close call, but ultimately will claim game number one. But that really goes to show you how evenly matched these two teams are, coming down to that 2v2, almost a 1v1 situation. Trill just holding on for dear life with that effuse over and over and over, but dot damage going to be a little bit too strong. And now it is going to be Noble's map as well as comp selection. That didn't look too bad for them, Sid.
That didn't look too bad for them. I just want to say four of the players died in that game.
Well, I'm just saying, they had a chance to win that matchup, right? Like, If it does come down to just like a 50-50 between these two teams, ultimately it will come down to whoever plays just that little bit better. But it seems like maybe they were caught off guard a little bit. Method Orange kind of went over to Jamili, put a little pressure on him. Maybe they weren't expecting Garecki to just get relentlessly trained down. But then again, it is Method Orange.
I actually almost wonder if Jamili could have won that. If he used Dispersion for mobility, it removes snares to chase Chun-Li. All he needed was one Shadow Word Death. I mean, he ultimately did use it, I believe, to move toward... No, he stops moving. I wonder if he had used Dispersion earlier before this point, moved in with it, and then just Shadowed Death. I guess Trill would just line of sight it.
Trill can just port away as well. He has the portal on the other pillar, so he could just port away if he gets into line.
Look at how many times he gets, like, one.
I mean, look how he almost... Well, maybe if he just 1v1 Mez... I don't. Yeah, I actually think that was possible.
Well,
I don't know.
If Jamili... When he silenced Mez, if he VT'd Mez and then went for the Mind Control... Then he could have maybe won it, but he went for just raw damage, and then he chased Trill, and I mean, you're not going to reach Trill at that point.
That's the worst situation in the world to be one of the opposing members. You're in a 1v2 situation. One person's 1% HP, and this other person is just making your life a nightmare, snaring you and gripping you and silencing you over and over and over. I'm sure we've all been in that situation before, but Method Orange, they're going to blind lock the Windwalker Death Knight Unholy once again, and now they're basically asking Noble, what are you going to pick?
RPS, if I'm... Well, RPS seemed really good for them. They could run some other things as well, but I think RPS, solid choice. If they played it a little bit better, they definitely could have won that game. I mean, we saw this matchup between The Move and Method Orange, and it was a close one, but The Move did manage to win that as RPS. So it's definitely a winnable matchup.
Honestly, I like what Noble's doing because this shows more signs of life for their team. You know, RPS obviously worked out very well for the move in this tournament season, and now they're sort of adopting that composition, which makes sense. You have Gorecki on the Wrestler Shaman, you have Rosies on the Subtlety Rogue, and Jamili, we know him for a multi-class, so he can play the Shadow Priest very well. So I think it's smart for them to adapt that composition, especially for tournaments moving forward.
I mean, another thing they could consider was the Thunder Cleave, if they've practiced that to this point. The Thunder Cleave has been super effective against the Windwalker Death Knight, especially the Unholy variant. I think the Unholy variant's even more less likely to beat Thunder Cleave, so I'm wondering if Noble are considering that while they're basically running their timer to lock in the composition that they're going to play.
They could do Outlaw LE again as well. They have a couple of options here. Jamili on the LE, Gorecki on the Wrist of Druid. Like you said, Thunder. They could just go RPS again as well. There's a lot of options here for Noble, and they have to decide which one is the correct one. We have a big map as well, so Thunder definitely could be a viable choice here.
That Noble basically running out of time at this point. They have to lock in their composition. We'll have to see which one they decide to go with. I'm curious, though. It does look like they're going with the Feral Druid Shadow Priest Holy Paladin. We saw them run this composition against Jungle, which is super effective. Is it going to be that strong against Method Orange, Windwalker, Death Knight? I don't know. The thing is, like, Jamili on the Shadow Priest, he's going to be very vulnerable to a lot of this pressure. Of course, he's going to have the support of Rub Cub on that Holy Paladin, but they can make the grip double swaps consistently over and over and over, and I think they can easily whittle down some of the defensive cooldowns that Noble has.
I'm more interested to know what strategy Noble are going to use. So obviously, Feral Druid and Shadow Priest do a lot of dot damage. They can hit multiple targets. So there's one way of playing this where they just try to kill the whole team. And then the other way they can play it is with the Repentance build on the Paladin and crowd control Seedew and then focus on damage on the other two targets. Depending on which strategy they pick on the big map, I feel like they should focus on the crowd control strategy, try and lock Seedew out of the game, use Blessing of Freedom to get Jamili to Seedew for fears, stuns, repentances, and then Trill and Mez will be very vulnerable to the dot damage and the spread pressure. If they can stay alive long enough for maybe threefold repentances, I think that they can close the game with that strategy.
Definitely. I think Method Orange also has an option where they can line of sight a lot. Like, as this composition, they don't need to play super aggressive. They can just make those swaps, like I said. They move on to Jamili when they do have the stuns available, grip Rub Cub on top of them, get the double setups, and eventually they will start working through some of those cooldowns. But we'll have to see how Noble responds. This isn't a composition we've seen too much out of them, but when we did see it last or 2 weeks ago, it seemed like they had practiced it quite a bit.
Well, if they pick... they picked this in the second game. I feel like they kind of knew what Method Orange was going to run. Method Orange always picks Windwalker DK pretty much in their blind pick. So did they think RPS had a bigger, had a better chance? Or why did they pick that in game number one instead of...
It is curious because we have seen Rosies as well play the Outlaw Rogue. And it actually worked against them. They played the Outlaw Rogue with the Elemental Shaman and Wrestler Druid. And that seemed like we thought that would be a good comp and ended up winning. Method Orange was forced off the Windwalker Death Knight. So I'm curious as to why they didn't lock that in again. Maybe in some war game practice or something like that. Their own meta between their two teams has evolved just a little bit. But it is very important that Noble wins this series. They need to be very certain that this composition is going to work out for them, because if they lose this series, it's going to be much more of a hill to climb in order to make it to that summer finals.
Yeah, and if Method Orange wins this series, they will be automatically qualified for...
Is that how it works?
For summer finals as well, yep.
Rich isn't here to do the math.
They are guaranteed third place in the standings.
Yep, you're right about that. So, yeah, very, very important. Like I said, Rich isn't here to do the math. Fortunately for us, we can quickly do that calculation. But, yeah, we'll be moving into this game very, very shortly. But, man, that was interesting for me, to say the least, because I like Method Orange going back to their default, being confident in it, locking it in game number two as well. And I'm surprised with Noble's pick, to be quite honest.
It seems like they're maybe desperate or just experimenting. I don't think the composition is necessarily that awful into the Windwalker Death Knight. It's more so a case of, have they practiced it enough? I mean, they did get the cross-kill and Seedo with the RPS. They're definitely capable of it, but maybe because they didn't have as much experience as the move, they took a couple of extra seconds too long to switch targets to Seedo. It seemed like they were reluctant to go after him in the early game, and then Seedo got comfortable and could even go for purges. So if they had just been all-out healer race from the beginning of the game, they might have been able to close it out with RPS. So maybe we see them switch back to that if this doesn't work out. I'm really curious to see what strategy they play, because the Feral Shadowpriest Holy Paladin has multitudes of play styles. It's not a one-trick pony.
Yeah, they are going to have a lot of crowd control available to them if that's the strategy that they decide to implement. One thing's for sure, Super Rejects is going to be watching this game with hawk eyes, because depending on who loses this, that is going to be their next opponent a little bit later on today. Like I said, we are going to be jumping into the game very, very shortly, but we'll have to see how this one plays out. Right now, Method Orange, they're up 1-0 in a very comfortable lead. Noble looking to strike back on Ashermain's Fall with the Shadow Priest Feral Paladin composition. Gorecki on the Feral, which we've seen him do quite well on in the past.
And Rubcup is not playing the Avenging Crusader right now, it seems.
I think it's smart.
I think that's a smart choice for sure. He's going to be a bit more susceptible to getting swapped, but overall, it's going to provide Jamili with a lot more defense so that they can prolong the game as long as they need to.
Yeah, and Gorecki's actually running Berserk, so he's dropped Incarnation for Soul to Forest so he can get more area of effect damage. That talent change kind of tells me that they're going to try and rot down the whole team, and Sidu's going to have to deal with triple damage threat.
Yeah, Trill charges in immediately. There's the double setup I was talking about. Jamili trinkets out, gets the double fear, but that was overlapped with the Rub Cub's trinket as well. So immediately, one leg sweep gets both trinkets from Noble. Full Repentance now secured onto Mez. Sidu not able to dispel that just yet, but Mez is just going to be caught into that crowd control. Full root now coming in from Gorecki. Mez decides to use the Wraith Walk, still putting out tons of pressure on the Jamili.
Yeah, they're trying to chase down Sidu and crowd control Mez. This is very similar to what Casca's Angels was trying to do to Envious in the previous series today, but I'm not sure if it's going to work out. Nice death grip behind the pillar, catching Jamili off guard and forcing a dispersion early on.
Yeah, and this is what I'm talking about. Method Orange seems very experienced in this matchup. Trill, though, having to play a little bit defensive now, using the Ride the Wind to kite back over onto Jamili to continue the shutdown. Touch of Death has been used, and actually a Blessing of Protection being used by Rubcup, but big pressure out onto Method Orange. Nicely done by Noble. Jamili getting low, though, still has the Void Shift Silence now onto Sidu. AMZ gets dropped out by Mez. Gorecki doing work.
Yeah, Sidu doesn't want to stay in that anti-magic zone. Unfortunately, maybe a bit misplaced from Mez for Sidu to stay in it. He would have to stay in the line of sight of the enemy team, so he opted to just avoid the damage completely by line of sighting. Ascendance has finally been forced from Sidu. Both 3-minute cooldowns, Healing Tide, Ascendance are out of the way. Those are area of effect recovery cooldowns. Super effective against a Feral Druid and a Shadow Priest. When you don't have those, you have to manually single target heal through all the damage, and it's going to put Sidu very far behind. The rest of this game is going to be difficult for him. I'm not sure if he's going to be able to overcome it as Trill gets swapped to. No Touch of Karma. He pre-walls the stun. They drop Spiritling Totem. Sidu knows that he can't recover from the area of effect damage, but Rubcup still has a slew of cooldowns to survive. This composition is paying dividends for Noble. They're just walking all over Method Orange right now.
The most important thing in this matchup is Rubcup just standing 50 million miles away. So
oh no, Gorecki!
Can't get that grip. Stun now onto Gorecki. He has no trinket available, but ultimately will survive. Doesn't even have to use the survival instinct, so that swap from Method Orange really didn't get too much there as Gorecki looks to close out this game. He's going to be charging in. Sidu getting very low on mana as well, dispelling some of those VT. But he gets feared up. Jamili now right on top of him, able to get out that pressure. Mez as well as Trill rotting low.
Double.
Big Shadow Crash comes in. Triple Fear coming in, and ultimately a big bite coming in from Gorecki will close out the game. And Noble, that composition looked insane for them.
They played a strategy that I haven't really seen since Cataclysm, where obviously a Death Knight is a big threat with uptime. In this matchup, they didn't even attack him. They're like, okay, you're a Death Knight, you do a lot of stuff, but we're going to Repentance you, we're going to Fear you, we're going to Stun you, we're going to Root you. And they basically removed the Death Knight from the game and made it effectively a 2v3 where they could just overwhelm Trill and Sidu. So maybe Sidu has to switch off Shaman and be a Paladin or something to get Mez more uptime, because he got crowd controlled for the longest duration. Look, Mez in a root, not able to move. He's got Wraithwalk every once in a while. He AMSs to try and avoid fear or something, but Mez got crowd controlled so heavily this game.
Yeah, Trill tried to do the best he could with the Tiger's Lust and stuff like that, but ultimately a lot of crowd control, like you were saying. This is it. Mame, Shadow Crash comes in. Just too much pressure for Cedar to really heal through. He didn't have any of the defensive cooldowns that he needed to survive. Zico, what did you think about this composition coming in from Noble?
I think it's a great answer. I mean, this is one of those comps that is super scary to go up against. You have so much unavoidable damage, essentially. As soon as the VTs gets rolling from the Shadow Priest, as well as those Feral Bleeds, then you can all of a sudden see everyone just drop down if a Repentance lands or a Stun lands, or if they do what they did in this case, where they just overwhelm you with all that damage and they just hit multiple people at the same time. So this is a nice comp from Noble. But I would have liked to see it in game number one. Mm-hmm. There's got to be a reason why we didn't see it in game number one, and are we gonna see that reason in game number three from Method Orange? Do they have an answer for Feral Shadow Priest Holy Paladin?
Yeah, very curious to see that. I think one of the most important things in the game I kind of touched on was Rubgub. He just stood so far away from Mez. Mez, you know, had to use that mobility if he wanted to get those death grips onto him so they could get those double setups. But then once you use the Wraithwalk, you don't have the root break anymore, and that's when you get caught into the roots, and you could really see Noble get a lot of pressure from that. It was just difficult. Method Orange didn't seem like they knew exactly what they wanted to do against that composition. Now they get to choose the map. They get to choose the comp. And like Zico said, are they going to have an answer for it?
Yeah, I mean, I think it's a strategy they weren't expecting. Normally, you don't crowd control the DPS like that. That's normally reserved for the healer.
True.
So having Mez basically effectively taken out of the game, and it didn't seem like they could really adapt to that. I'm not sure what the best answer is. Maybe just run down Rubcub because he's running Repentance, and he's effectively working like a mage to control the Death Knight. So if they run him down and take Repentance out of the game by running him down, that could be a way to deal with it. At the same time, if they do that, then Jamili's free. He's killing the whole team, I think, at that point, if they decide to change their strategy from, okay, the Death Knight, we can't crowd control him if he does this, so instead we'll just attack him and kill everybody. So this is like a lose-lose situation for Method Orange, I think.
You know what else really is unfortunate for Sidhu is the Repentance goes out on a Mez. If he gets dispelled, then
Hammer.
VTs.
Yeah.
No, VTs cannot be dispelled. So he's protecting Jamili's VTs, essentially. And if Sidhu does go for the more defensive play and dispels the VTs, then Mez just gets caught into that crowd control. So very interesting coming in from Noble. They had the right strat. The right comp, Method Orange, are they going to have a response? Maybe they go to the Frost Death Knight. Sometimes we see them with the Windwalker Decay go from the Unholy to the Frost, depending on what they're playing against.
Yeah, they like to switch it up, and that's the biggest comp adaptation that we usually do see from Method Orange, have Mez switch between those Death Knight specs, but they do have a bunch of compositions available. We've seen Mez, of course, on his Demon Hunter, seen Trill on things like Warriors.
Don't forget Samiam, too.
Oh, yeah, there's that
guy. Oh, yeah, that guy.
That guy.
I forgot about him. But yeah, of course, Samiam as well on that Elemental Shaman could shut down Jamili, have a lot of extra Earthshock stuns and Wind Shears and things like that to kind of force Jamili to play a little bit more defensive and not get those fears.
Yeah, I mean, we might have to see Samiam step in and save the team in this matchup. Noble taking a little bit of time here. Actually, they have selected Tiger's Peak, so I think it's going to be Method Orange now who selects the comp. Or no, sorry, Noble's
gonna, Noble.
Yeah, Noble selects the composition. Getting a little bit jumbled here.
I think they have to be worried about blind locking the Holy Paladin Feral Shadow Priest, because if they do that, I think Method Orange just play Thunder. And they can just kind of drag the game out and almost and just dampen Noble. We've seen Method Orange do that in the past when they fight a composition. They just go back to the Thunder on these picks to counter comp it. And I think it would be very effective against that. And that's why Noble is trying to consider. Maybe that's why they don't want to play. That's why they played the RPS. They were maybe worried of Thunder or something in the first game instead. These teams probably have practiced against each other quite a bit on the ladder. So they've kind of felt each other out. And that's why we're seeing such interesting comp choices overall in the metagame from both of them. I think RPS actually is the right move from Noble to Blindlock.
Yeah, because it wasn't a bad matchup in game number one. It literally almost came down to a 1v1 situation, so it was very close. Like Zico was saying, if Noble just played a little bit better, but they are going to be defaulting in the Holy Pally with the Feral Druid, with the Shadow Priest comp. We saw it last or two weekends ago from them. Worked out well. Now, surprisingly, against Windwalker, Death Knight seems to be strong as well, but like you said, Method Orange, they have a lot of different options. They could bring in the Thundercleave if they want, tag in Samiam, sort of just try to outlast Noble, really put a lot of pressure out with that Arms Warrior and that Elemental Shaman. Maybe Method Orange doesn't know that's a good answer, and that's I think maybe one of the good reasons Noble or one of the reasons Noble decided to go with this comp is because maybe Method Orange doesn't have that much experience with it.
I think it's a smart call to stick with it, but there's two ways you can do the blind pick. Either you pick your standard comp that's best overall against anything that Method Orange can run.
This is a comp we know well.
This is a comp that we know well.
Hey, we all play those classes.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's us.
Yeah, that's us.
But I'm not sure if we beat that. That's an Arcane Mage versus the Feral Druid.
Yeah, I don't know.
I'm not sure if we like this comp.
Shadow Priest dispelling your displacement. I think they could get a lot of pressure, but I think it's going to be very difficult as well. So.
Yeah, I think as soon as Noble gets pressure onto the Arcane Mage, if there's no Iron Bark, they can kind of just run away with that pressure and force cooldowns from Method Orange.
I kind of feel like this is Method Orange saying we weren't expecting this. We were not expecting this comp from Noble. Hopefully this works.
That's the thing about when you do these blind picks, you have to choose. Either you take what you think is best against everything that they can run, or you just play what you just played and make them force you off it. Yeah, because, I mean, if Noble wins this, this is the swing match, right? It's 1-1.
Yep.
So Noble really got to win this one. And if they do, they will have that blind pick advantage later. So if they manage to win this game, they will have that blind pick advantage if it goes to game 5.
Yeah, and like we kind of talked about, Method Orange, if they win the series, they guarantee qualify to the summer finals. Obviously a very important series for them. But on the other hand, Noble is going to be in a very very good position as well if they can pull this off. So both teams desperately trying to win, trying to move forward into that LAN tournament a little bit later on in the summer. But Method Orange with a surprising composition. I think this is the first time, or not the first time, we've seen Samiam and Trill together. That's how they play their Thunder as well. But the Arcane Mage with the Windwalker Monk isn't something we see too often anymore.
I'm not the biggest fan of it. I think Thunder or even Windwalker Ellie would have been better overall. I feel like the Arcane Mage is going to be really vulnerable in this matchup, and you can get overwhelmed as a Resto Druid against Shadow Priest Dot. If he had an Ellie to self-healing himself, that kind of sustains him through that. Arcane Mage not going to be doing a lot of self-healing outside of Temporal Shield, so Sidhu could fall behind in this series. He's going to have a difficult time if Jamili can really get those dots rolling.
And that's one of the things about Jamili being a multi-classer, is he knows how to best mess with an Arcane Mage, dispel the displacement, dispel the Temporal Shield immediately. Gorecki looking to defend. Full Polymorph over on a Rubcub. Big swap on Jamili right away as he is forced into that dispersion. I don't think it's a bad trade. Just the images coming in from Trill. It didn't actually activate anything else. Jamili still getting low. Rubcub not out of the crowd control just yet. He has to Trinket to use the Sacrifice. So it's actually a very good opener for Method Orange.
Yeah, good crowd control chain from Method Orange. And in one crowd control chain, they're able to force both Dispersion and Blessing of Sacrifice. If they can get another round of that, the third round, there will be nothing really left for Jamili to stand. In the meantime now, though, it's Noble turn to attack. Shadow Crash moving in towards Samiam, but Gorecki got paralysis away. Good teamwork from Trill trying to stall this out. Samiam looking for a Polymorph Vortex on Rubcup. Samiam getting interrupted, but a double fist to set up for Samiam potentially here. Mind Control right at the end of the Polycast. He Trinkets out of the Mind Control to land the Polymorph, but they cycling up Jamili right at the end of it. Now swapping over to Rubcup instead, trying to bait some cooldowns from him, trying to pressure him down. He's on half HP. Looks like he's going to be able to recover. Trill now getting swapped to. He's below half. Full fear onto Sidhu. Arcane Missiles flying in. Touch of Karma traded out. Both teams so evenly matched.
Yeah, Bash over on the Trill. He has no Touch of Karma as well as they chase him down. Silence on the Sidhu. Trill could be in so much trouble. Fortifying Elixir gets used. Iron Bark as well. Trill uses the Incapacitate on the Gorecki to play a little bit defensive, but this is the snowball pressure we see from Noble. This composition is very scary if they can get their dots rolling.
Ooh, Rubcup was sneaky there, looking for a Repentance. Sidhu saw it coming and shapeshifted. Sidhu actually opts to Trinket out of the incoming stun to look for an offensive clone. He lands the clone on the Trinket of Rubcup with Elixir Gun. Gorecki, good crowd control, nets them a dispersion, but in the meantime, the counter pressure nets an ice block from Samiam as both teams continue swinging.
Yeah, Jamili still low though, gets out of that dispersion. Samiam now activating that ice block to get out of it. Gonna be putting on a little pressure now on Jamili, just spamming with the Polymorphs actually with a defensive play. Rubcup looking for the Repentance. Trill is very scared in the situation. He has no Trinket, he has no Karma. If Gorecki can land a full stun, he's gonna be in a lot of trouble. So he doesn't have a Trinket either. There's the full bash on Trill. He gets Human Racial off. So he gets the Human Racial, he's out of the stun, throws a Double Fist of Fear onto Jamili and Gorecki to really slow down their pressure, manage to survive just a little bit longer.
Jamili used the Life Swap there on Gorecki. Now he's not gonna have that. There's no sacrifice for three more seconds. Can they net in a kill? Mark of Alaneth has been channeled out, but Samiam is getting counter pressured at the same time. Double legs, a critical mistake by the team of Noble, forcing a Divine Shield sacrifice. Now they switch over to Gorecki, who is still low. Samiam, Trill, both rotting down. 8 seconds on Touch of Karma, 6 seconds on Touch of Karma. Samiam looking for defensive Polymorphs, trying to get control for Sidhu to recover as he's fallen so far behind, but now netting in a Polymorph. No dispersion for 18. Both Samiam and potentially Jamili in a lot of trouble. If Samiam can survive this, will he be able to? Gets interrupted on the damage. Fist of Fear on Jamili. Full Cyclone on Rubka, but a silence now onto Sidhu. And there's a Blessing of Protection spell stolen by Samiam, allowing him to remove the bleeds. Nice play. Now Jamili's in trouble with the Polymorph secured. Jamili will not fall. Dispersion at the final seconds allows him a moment of breathing room.
Yeah, manages to get topped off immediately with that Divine Favor coming from Rubka as well. Now Trill a little bit low. Activates the Touch of Karma. They want to continue this pressure onto Jamili. DR Sheep goes out onto Rubka. Unfortunately, DR'd. Full Cyclone, though, coming in from Sidhu. Nicely done. Mass Dispel, I believe, coming from Jamili will remove that Cyclone. And now Noble has an opportunity to get a lot of pressure here onto Samiam. Trill as well. Like we said, no Touch of Karma for quite some time. If they can continue this pressure, Trill's forced to port away. Samiam into the middle of the map right now. Sidhu's going to have to play catch up. Down to around 50% mana. Gorecki going over for the full main stun. Jamili in a good position to land that full fear. Now Samiam's all alone, but good pressure out onto Jamili. Double life sweep coming in from Trill as both Jamili and Gorecki get rotted down.
I mean, this has to be the end of the game. Double Fist of Fury, no defensive cooldowns remaining as Jamili desperately spams out mind control, but Rubcub is still locked down by Samiam. Sidhu moves in for the game-winning clone, but Jamili mind controls Trill away to buy at least a couple more seconds. Powered shield, but it's not enough as Jamili gets closed out. Sidhu and Samiam tag teaming for an infinity crowd control chain on Rub Cub and sneaking away with a victory despite immense counter pressure throughout that match.
Yeah, the one thing Method Orange really had going for them is that Rub Cub is a Holy Paladin, and Arcane Mages and Resto Druids are going to have a good time landing that crowd control, and that's ultimately what got them the victory.
Yeah, Samayam had a phenomenal performance in that game. Came off cold from the bench and did work. He landed a lot of polymorphs onto Rub Cub, really had a nice amount of control in that game. Trill, of course, also landing a lot of crucial double leg sweeps, as we just saw right there, with another double fist as well. And I mean, Seedoo here as well, doing such a great job casting together with Samayam there and making sure that, hey, Gorecki, if you want to stop somebody, it's either me or Sam. One of us is going to get that crowd control and be able to close out the game. So Seedoo and Samayam, they worked well together as well. My only critique of Noble here is that I think Gorecki should have had a lot more pressure on that Arcane Mage. And I mean, that could be because of Gorecki playing a bit too defensive or spreading his damage out too much, or that could also be because Jamili isn't helping him by purging out those displacements when he sees that Samayam is double blinking to get these sheeps on Rob Cub and things like that. So just more pressure on the Mage. You already forced the block super early in the game. You could easily close it out the next time you have Incarnation if you play a card trait.
Yeah, all you need is a Silence into a Hodge or something like that in order to take them down. Like you said, if Jamili was able to assist with the Dispel on the Displacement, they could ultimately take him down. But now Noble in a position where they just lost, so it's their map pick as well as their comp pick. Do you think they'll default back to this, Ed?
I think Subtlety RPS into the Arcane Mage team, I think, would just decimate them with proper setups and mash purge. With double purge against a druid, Subtlety RPS can be one of the scariest comps as a resto druid to heal through. It's got all the things it needs to win: instant crowd control, switch potential, and double purge for hots. So I would like to see that from Noble, depending on what Method Orange lock in. Obviously, they don't have to play the Arcane Mage. Maybe they switch to Thunder or something of the like.
I actually think bringing in a resto shaman instead of the Holy Paladin could also be good, having the resto shaman Shadow Priest Feral. The problem is your resto shaman is also your Feral. We do know Rub Cub can play the Shaman, so it'll be interesting to see if they do bring him in on the resto Shaman to heal Gorecki on the Feral, because I do think that would be a reasonable answer for what Method Orange is bringing.
Well, I think the most important thing here to talk about is what is actually Method Orange going to be picking. I don't think they're going to pick the Arcane Mage with the resto Druid and Windwalker blind. I think that we're more likely to see maybe a Frost Death Knight Windwalker DK or an Unholy Death Knight Windwalker DK even come out of them. And I mean, it wasn't super, it was kind of one-sided on Azure Mains, but it wasn't the most one-sided. Maybe if they pick Frost, they can make that matchup a little bit more swung in their favor.
Yeah, we'll definitely have to see. I think it really was a surprise factor that Noble was bringing with that composition and with the strategy to just CC Mez. Black Rook Hold Arena selected by Noble. And I feel like this is Noble almost baiting Method Orange. Like, hey, it's a small map. Do you want to play Windwalker DK? Fair deal, right? We'll have to see if Method Orange falls for the bait, or maybe they're thinking something else.
I mean, they could also be shooting themselves in the foot here, because if they do pick Windwalker DK and Noble plays Feral SP, one of the big reasons why they were so dominant in the Asherman's game was because Rub Cub was on the other side of the map, making it impossible for Mez to do anything.
Yeah, so if the map is a little bit smaller, it's going to be easier for Mez to get the Death Grips onto Rub Cub so they can get those double Fist of Fury, double leg sweep setups that we know they love to pull off, and that's ultimately where they will be getting a lot of that pressure from. Method Orange has about a minute left on selecting their composition. I think I actually don't mind them just locking in the Windwalker Death Knight. I think on the smaller map, they must know that it's going to be easier for them to get those double setups.
I mean, the easiest strategy here, to keep it simple, is Windwalker DK, run at the healer, hope you win. If you don't, you've got game five to rely on with map and comp advantage. I think it's the best pressure. It's literally the best pressure decision that they can make. It's saying, okay, whatever healer you put in, Gorecki or Rub Cub, you better be ready, because we're just going to run you down. You make one mistake, this is over. We advance and we qualify. And if we don't, you still got to deal with this counter potentially in game five. And that's what I would like to see from Method Orange strategically, I think.
I like that.
Maybe they're on the same page as you. Looks like they locked in the composition for that healer all in, if that's what they want to use. Noble, now 2 minutes to decide what comp they want to be bringing. I think they're probably going to end up just locking in the same thing. It seems so convincing
instantly.
In game number two. Instantly locking this in once again. But like we said, Method Orange on this map should theoretically have a much easier time making sure they get that pressure out that they need.
Yeah, I don't understand the Black Rook Hold pick here, because It's so good for the Windwalker DK if they sit in the room and try to just grip Gorecki in or try to grip Jamili in, anyone they can really. They can build up a lot of momentum for free essentially by doing that and just abusing the room. And also it's a small map, so if they want to go for the Super T strat where they just run at Rub Cup the entire game.
Super T, so it's not my strat, it's Kolo's strat.
It's debatable.
There's been a lot of people.
There's a lot of people that running healers.
I don't. Yeah, there's a lot of people.
Call that Realzing.
Realzing, Viving.
How many Windwalker DKs at 2K rating run at a healer every game? It's probably in the thousands.
Every single game. Every single game. Never slow it down. But yeah, Method Orange, they got the comp. This is their bread and butter. Noble has a good answer. Potentially on the smaller map, like Seiko said, they may have shot themselves in the foot. It could potentially backfire, but they had a very convincing win on game number two on Ashmain's Fall. But this series is just so important. You really can't be making any mistakes.
I was just going to say, it's match point. So, and Noble have not had a good track record in the lower bracket. So I feel like they need to stay in the upper bracket if they want a shot.
Yeah, I think the map... It's definitely a crucial mistake here, but if you know that you want to play this matchup, you could just pick a bigger map, let Method blind pick, and then you will have that big map advantage. Now you're gonna have to work with being a counter, but on essentially one of the best maps for the Windwalker DK. So this could end right here, and if it does, then Method Orange are going to Poland.
Yep.
Semifinals.
They're going to Poland, and then we'll see Noble move down to the lower bracket to go up against the Super Rejects, which is obviously not an easy team by any stretch of the imagination. So it's going to be difficult. A lot on the line in this series here as we move into game number four very, very shortly. We kind of, Sid wants to see Method Orange kind of all in Rub Cup. I'm not convinced on that strategy. I think if you leave Jamili alone and you leave Gorecki alone on the Feral Druid and the Shadow Priest, they're going to be able to cause a lot of pressure. Maybe if they're going on to Rub Cup and they're gripping in Jamili and getting double stuns that way, making sure they at least control up some of those dots coming in. Because if you leave the Shadow Priest alone for too long, he's going to be causing mass pressure.
I mean, the main goal that they need to do is get Mez out of crowd control. That should be the main point of contention, because that's what lost in the game on Ashermains. Mez just could get no uptime whatsoever. So if Seidu and Trill both focus on supporting Mez with Ride the Wind, with Tiger's Lust, with Dispels being in line of sight to Dispel, and they can get Mez going, they can definitely still take this. So let's see. It's match point. Method Orange could just push down the gas pedal, run at Rub Cup, start to finish, and end this series, making it very difficult for Noble to still qualify. Or Noble could strike back with this interesting strategy by locking Mez out of the game with crowd control and just killing Seidu and Trill at the same time. It's still anyone's series.
Yep, very important that Noble comes back in this series. For Method Orange, if they win this game, they do qualify for the summer final. So they're going to be putting it all on the line here in game number four as the gates open.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, who do you think is going to take it? Seidu changing his talent to Relentless at that final second, as he is likely to be attacked at some point once those stuns and silences reduced every time. Rub Cup hiding in the room. He's kind of expecting to be the target. He's hiding. They've gripped Jamili back behind the pillar for a surprise attack. Jamili trinkets and lands a double psychic scream, allowing him to free cast Vampiric Touches. No, Mez, nice mind freeze, interrupting the ramp of the Shadow Priest, now trying to get the ramp going. Seidu has Urshield on himself. He's expecting to be targeted. Cap Totem out of the in cap, out of line of sight of Rub Cup, trying to bait Rub Cup to move in. Silence on Seidu. They're going for the all in switch to Rub Cup. He human Rachel's out. He's retreating away. Seidu trying to purge off those Blessing of Freedoms. There's so many interrupts for Rub Cup to go through. Is he going to be able to be greedy here and hold on to the Avenging Wrath? He's doing his best to do so. Earthen Shield Totem, Healing Tide down. They're going all in for Rub Cup's life.
This plan can backfire, but they might get the bubble here. Seidu getting feared up. Rub Cup bubbling at 1% HP. Tops himself off immediately, but this is so scary. He still has a Blessing of Protection. Trill getting low, though, activating the Fortifying Elixir. You can see Mez and Trill just sitting on top of Rub Cup. They heard you, Supertease.
I mean, it's Smork all the way home. Do or die. Will Rub Cup fall? This is his last opportunity to carry the team. Gorecki trying to build momentum on Seidu in the back line. Rub Cup retreating away. Gets wind shift by Seidu. Three kicks available. Void shift from Jamili backing him up, but he needs more than one health bar. He probably needs more than two. Rub Cup's in so much trouble as Method Orange gunned down for the all-in. Stun. Blessing of Protection available. He holds a purge instantly. He catches one Holy Light, but the mind controls and stuns might be enough for Rub Cup. He's hanging up by a third. Hammer of Justice on Seidu.
Sidhu. Noble trying to strike back. Could be a potential cross kill. Spareling Totem, though, available. Sidhu restabilized, and Rubcub has to be panicking right now. Sidhu just gunning him down with purges.
Trill.
Who cares about Trill? I'm pressing purge. Rubcub, though, might have been able to do it. This could be the light at the end of the tunnel. The mind controls have been so critical for Rubcub to survive.
Yeah, Mez has been caught in that roof for so long. Trill still getting low. Rubcub caught into the full stun. Can they take him down and qualify for the summer finals? Full stun on Rubcub. He tips behind the corner. Purge is coming in. Sidhu looking to interrupt. Mez, Trill,
what?
And Sidhu all over the place. Rubcub with the unbelievable kites, keeping himself alive. What an incredible job. Silence now on Sidhu.
Oh, no,
completely
oh, no.
Barely holding on. How are you alive right now? Ultimately will fall, but still,
wait.
Orange in a lot of trouble.
Greki needs to press survival instincts. He just needs to press it and kill. Trill's so low. He pulls away. He falls. Sidhu's got no mana. Sidhu could easily go down as well. He ducks behind the pillar. Mez trying to carry. Sidhu could easily fall. Greki all over him. He's still got Sidhu's got nothing. He's literally got nothing. He's got absolutely nothing. Is he going to be able to do it? He's caught in the stun. Mez gets speared away. Jamili moves in. Shadow Ward Death. He's hanging on by a thread. Earthen Shield Totem now available. Plops that down instantly. Jamili trying to heal himself back up. Sidhu starting to stabilize. Can he do it?
Can he stay alive just a little bit longer? Greki and Jamili need to close out this game. Sidhu gets interrupted, but the Earthen Shield Totem makes him so tanky with that Earth Shield. Jamili forced into the dispersion. They're trying to stay alive for as long as they can, but I think Noble has ran out of time. Sidhu somehow deflects all of this incoming pressure.
Oh, stun.
Greki looking for the play. There's
Fear.
A full stun. Double Fear comes in into a silence on Sidhu. Can they take him down? Mez in a good spot, maybe to win the 1v2 if it does end up happening, but the AMZ looks like it will shut it down.
Yeah, Sidhu should be able to restabilize here. He's going to go back to full HP. He's got Astral Shift. Method Orange are now in a commanding position. Mez can basically just do whatever he wants. Heat Trinket's out of the stun, and I think this is it. Double Cap Totem from Method Orange. The all-in strategy ultimately crushes Rubcub. It was a valiant fight right down to the bitter end. But despite all of their efforts, I believe Noble will have to continue this battle in the lower bracket. They're just annoying Method Orange, trying to make it out of this alive, but it's not enough. Method Orange do it. They throw everything at Noble. The all-in banks in the win. 3-1. They advance to the summer final.